Welcome to Nano Matters, the podcast that explores examples of nanotechnology. I'm Lisa Friedersdorf, director of the National Nanotechnology Coordination Office. Here with me today is Pamela Bjorkman, the David Baltimore Professor of Biology and Biological Engineering at Caltech. Pamela, could you tell us a little bit about your ongoing research in vaccines?
Sure, and thank you for having me today. There's been a huge amount of success, as everyone knows, in very quickly making effective and safe vaccines that will protect against COVID-19, the disease that's caused by SARS-CoV-2 infection. And it's been just inspiring and wonderful to see how fast that happened. That's just amazing. Well, the reason it happened so fast was because there were years of basic research behind the, for example, messenger RNA-based vaccines from Pfizer and Moderna. That was based on years of research and understanding of coronavirus. My research is on the sort of structures of what the coronavirus spike looks like. That's the viral protein that's delivered as a gene in these sorts of vaccines. And so what my lab would do would be look at the three-dimensional shapes and the details of the atomic interactions when the spike is recognized by antibodies, which are proteins produced by your immune system. So we are trying to understand exactly how antibodies bind to that spike and then do what's called neutralize the virus, so they stop it from infecting. By understanding that, one can design a vaccine, and one can also perhaps develop better antibodies that could be used as therapeutics. So as everyone probably knows, there are some monoclonal antibodies, single antibodies that were developed by pharmaceutical companies, by Eli Lilly and Regeneron, for example, that can be used after someone has gotten infected. So by understanding how those antibodies actually recognize their targets, which are the spike proteins on these viruses, we could probably design ones that would work, that would be better. So we're just trying to understand the basic principles of how antibodies recognize the virus so that we could, number one, make vaccines that would make better antibodies, or number two, re-engineer those antibodies so they work better.
I've read that in your research, you are looking to design these vaccines that could address mutations or variants that occur in the virus. Could you discuss that aspect of your work?
So what we're trying to do is prepare for the next pandemic, which unfortunately I'm afraid that there will be a SARS-CoV-3 and maybe a SARS-CoV-4, and that's based on just the fact that in the past 20 years, we've had the first SARS epidemic, and then we had MERS, and now we have SARS-CoV-2. These are viruses that emerged from animal reservoirs and passed into humans, and all the indications are this won't be the last time that happens. And we were just lucky most of the time that viruses that pass into humans from animals have not been as transmissible as SARS-CoV-2. So what we're trying to do is protect against future transmission events. And simultaneously, if we could do that, we would be protecting against these SARS-CoV-2 variants of concern, which are mutations that have arisen in SARS-CoV-2 because it has infected so many millions of people worldwide. It doesn't mutate that fast, but if you infect that many people, you're going to find advantageous mutants that kind of take over through natural selection. So what we're trying to do is based on a nanoparticle technology in which we covalently attach parts of the spike proteins to these small protein-based nanoparticles and then use that as a vaccine. So the vaccines today, they present pieces of the SARS-CoV-2 spike protein. But what we've done is to attach pieces of many different coronavirus proteins to the same nanoparticle so that what's presented to your immune system are, for example, 8 different coronavirus spike protein pieces. And so the idea then is that you could protect not only against SARS-CoV-2, but these other coronaviruses that researchers know about. When we did experiments with this, where we immunized mice and we looked at their immune response in the forms of the antibodies that they raised, what we found was this type of what we called mosaic nanoparticle elicited more cross-reactive antibody responses. So that means that the antibodies not only worked against SARS-CoV-2, but they worked against other coronaviruses that we tested against. And one of the most encouraging things was they were able to neutralize, that means prevent infection in a laboratory experiment, they could neutralize viruses that did not have pieces of themselves represented on these mosaic nanoparticles. In other words, we're hoping that they would work against even things we haven't seen before. Because if the protection is broad enough, it would work against, you know, new variants that might arise and then coronaviruses that might spill into humans that we don't yet know what they are.
So this mosaic nanoparticle-based vaccine platform, is that similar, as you just described, being able to neutralize viruses that perhaps were not specifically targeted? Is that the same concept where I've heard the universal flu vaccine under development?
Yes and no. There are many different concepts for universal flu vaccines that people are trying to develop. Influenza is a more rapidly mutating virus than coronaviruses are. So there are all these strains of flu that circulate every year. And what is done now is the World Health Organization predicts which are the most common ones that might arise in the upcoming flu season. And then they just make three or four different of those viruses and put them into a vaccine. To make a universal flu vaccine, you'd have to make something that would induce antibodies to part of the flu virus that is conserved across everything. Now, that's really hard because flu tends to vary. And when it doesn't vary parts of itself, it hides those from your immune system. So what I'm getting at is there are sort of two ways one might make a universal flu vaccine or a universal coronavirus vaccine. One way would be you'd try to raise antibodies, immune response proteins, antibodies, against part of the particular viral protein that doesn't vary from one viral strain to another. And there are such parts on coronavirus spikes. Now, that's not what we're doing. That's not our approach. What we've done instead is we're taking these protein-based nanoparticles, and they've been developed by Mark Howarth's lab at Oxford to include a protein that sticks out and acts like a molecular Velcro. So it's like this little soccer ball-like cage with 60 pieces of Velcro that are sticking out. And now what we do is we take parts of the spike proteins from eight different coronaviruses, and these are all SARS-related coronaviruses, and we attach another piece of molecular Velcro. And now when we mix the nanoparticle with the Velcro with the coronavirus pieces with the Velcro, they link together covalently. And now that's what we would call a mosaic nanoparticle. So now when we've done experiments with these in mice, what we see is that the mice make a cross-reactive immune response. So that means that their immune system recognizes the pieces of viruses that are on that particle. But then, as I was alluding to, they also make responses to viruses where the piece of that particular virus was not on the mosaic nanoparticle. So we think this shows the potential for cross-reactive recognition that goes beyond what's actually presented there on the nanoparticle.
So are there other diseases that you think could be impacted by this approach?
Well, yeah, and it's being done by many researchers around the world, this type of approach. My lab is working on HIV, where we're making similar nanoparticles, except in this case, there are HIV proteins attached with this Velcro technology. We're in the middle of experiments in non-human primates in those vaccine attempts. You know, it's very hard to make an HIV vaccine. That's why there isn't one now, despite 30 or more years of effort. That virus mutates even faster than influenza virus. So there are, like, within a single infected person, there are more strains of HIV than there are influenza strains in the whole world. So, like, that kind of variability is just really hard to deal with. So that's a tough, tough problem. But we're trying various engineering concepts to make the things we present on the nanoparticles possibly induce cross-reactive responses. So there's a lot of work in many research labs around the world to use these types of nanoparticles to present pieces of other viruses. So this is being done for, I've named a few, influenza, HIV, coronaviruses.
So what is the next step with this vaccine platform?
Well, what we want to do is show that we can achieve protection from a coronavirus where we don't have a piece of its protein on our particle. So we call this mismatched. Okay, so let's say we make a mosaic 8 nanoparticle and there are pieces of 8 different coronaviruses on it. And then we test them in the laboratory for the ability to neutralize each of those 8 coronaviruses. So if we do something like that, the answer is yes, they will neutralize. So that we would call matched. But what we're really interested in is the ability to protect against mismatched coronaviruses where there's not a piece of a particular coronavirus on the particle. So to actually prove that, we need to do a challenge experiment in an animal model. And so these are difficult because you're working with authentic SARS-CoV-2 viruses and other dangerous viruses. And they have to be done in a biosafety level 3 facility. So the experiment is like this. You take the mosaic 8 nanoparticles, you inject them as if it's a vaccine into a set of non-human primates. And then after they've had a chance to develop their immune responses against this vaccine, you challenge one set of them with SARS-CoV-2. That's the matched strain. And then you challenge another set of non-human primates with conventional SARS, so SARS-CoV-1. And there's no pieces of SARS-CoV-1 on these nanoparticles. And so you just ask, are these non-human primates protected from both SARS-CoV-2, which they will be because this has been shown many times that these sorts of vaccines are protective. But what we want to see is, will they be protected from a challenge with SARS as well? So that's our next step.
That's very exciting. So how do you envision your research having an impact in the future? I mean, so as you progress in this research and develop these vaccines, where do you hope the impact is?
Well, this is my dream. What I would love to see is that one option for people getting vaccinated against SARS-CoV-2 is that they could choose to be vaccinated with a mosaic nanoparticle that would protect them against SARS-CoV-2. But they then hopefully would have protection against something else that might appear in the future that we don't know what it is yet. And so if we can show that this type of mosaic approach is just as effective against SARS-CoV-2 as an approach where everything you're putting into the vaccine is a SARS-CoV-2-based protein, then what would be the disadvantage of getting the mosaic vaccine? Because you'd have further protection. It should also protect against the variants of concern in SARS-CoV-2 itself because it's less affected by these sorts of mutations by definition. So I would love to see that as an option for a vaccine. I should also point out that these nanoparticle-based vaccines can be lyophilized so that they can be converted into a powder, which is stable at room temperature, so you'd have no cold chain issues. So the idea was you would just stockpile this powder and then bring it up as a vaccine, which would protect against SARS-CoV-2 and its variants now and protect people, hopefully, in the future against something that might emerge. Like if we were all vaccinated with this, then if another emerging coronavirus comes out of an animal reservoir, the prediction and hope would be it could not spread through humans. So that's my dream. It's much harder to make things with 8 or more different coronavirus proteins than it is to make things with only one type of coronavirus protein. So there are manufacturing challenges to that, but that's how I envision the work might have an impact in the future.
Well, that's very encouraging. I want to thank you for taking the time to talk with us today. I really enjoyed learning more about your research. Do you have any closing thoughts that you'd like to share with our listeners?
If you're a young person and you're trying to decide what type of career you'd like to go into, I'd strongly encourage you to consider science. To me, it's very satisfying to think about just sort of basic experiments. I really like trying to plan things out logically, and I like seeing the results. And I like it when experiments don't work, because that usually tells you what you should do to make them work. So I find science to be very interesting. It can be frustrating at times, but it really keeps me engaged and I really enjoy it. So I hope a lot of young people will consider some form of science as a career path.